Should children be spanked? Is that even a form of discipline, or is that abuse? Is that punishment rather than discipline? Is that training anybody, or is that only shaming them? And I think this is a conversation that is really important in this day, in this age.
Well, guys, today, Addison and I are here at the table because I am probably the most of this one thing. What is that one thing? We'll get to that in just a moment. And Addison's probably the second most.
Second most. Probably.
And Mom, I think you have a story to kind of kick us off into explaining what the heck we're
just
talking about.
Right to me, right there.
Go for it.
Okay, well, we are talking about disciplining. We're talking about how to mark
our children. Oh, you just went straight into it? I thought you were going to give the story.
Without leaving a mark, yes.
All right.
Well, Alec, you were always the most entertaining child when it came to discipline.
That's a really good way to put that.
I remember.
This is not the story we agreed on.
Yeah, this is a story. So Austin had a soccer game. Addison needed to go to the junior high for like an awards thing. And I was getting you and Arden into the car when this other mother of boys said, oh, I'll watch Alec and Arden. You don't need to take them. And I pulled her aside and said, now you have to really watch him. Like, I wasn't concerned about Arden, but I was concerned about you. And she was like, oh, yeah, no problem. So I drive, I want to say 5 minutes one way. I should probably gone 20 minutes. No. And I come back and there is a child down on the ground and parents are surrounding the child and you're kind of standing to the side. And I immediately felt nauseous. I was like,
you knew.
Why am I afraid my son has something to do with the child down on the ground? And all I can remember is, you said something, and I'm great with you speaking to this part. You said, I just flicked him. I just flicked him in the nose. There was a bloody nose.
Yeah.
There was.
Okay. Well, actually.
Can you explain the flick?
I can totally explain the flick, but I'll explain that in a moment. You might as well just actually finish the story because I don't want to interrupt where you're actually going with this.
And I remember people are like, aren't you the people building the ministry building down the street? I was like, nope, that is not us. I have no idea who those people are. I've get asked that a lot. And I remember, you know, we came home, we ate dinner, and I was sitting with you on the lower bunk bed, and I was like, Alec, that was the first time I was actually embarrassed to say, yes, that is my son. I wanted to pretend like, nope, that I have no idea who that child is.
And I said, Mom, it was the first time I was embarrassed too.
You did. You were like, I was embarrassed too. And then you explained to me that when John, your father, had left without disciplining you, spanking you.
Well, obviously,
that a wolf was in your heart, that a wolf came into your heart and that you did something you didn't plan on doing.
Yeah, Dad was supposed to spank me for something else before he left for a trip. And I pretended to be asleep so that he wouldn't spank me. And it worked. But
I do remember your dad saying,
I can't believe that worked. I remember Dad in that season. Anyway, that was a bold move. That could have got you an extra spanking.
By the way, just for the record, all right?
It was late. He'd stayed in his office for a long time.
The flicking was this. So I did play basketball. I did play baseball back then, and I had a pretty mean arm. And there was this kid that was picking on Arden.
Is this turning into a Thanos moment? And like he can snap his fingers, and I can flick and take our person? Is that where this is going?
I didn't flick
and baseball used together.
I flicked the ball, I said, essentially, because he was picking on Arden. So I was actually defending my little brother. He was bullying Arden. And I got his attention. I said, hey, and he looked my way, and I kind of flicked the ball his direction, which meant I kind of threw it at full speed into his face.
Wait. Time out.
Broke his nose. Yes.
I have never understood this story until
now. You didn't know that?
No, so you actually threw the ball at his face?
Oh, you thought
I literally.
I thought you legitimately punched him and you called it a flick.
No. This kid was bullying Arden. I reached down, picked up a. I don't think it was a baseball. I think it was like a tennis ball.
No, it was a softball.
All right, it was a softball then.
But it was
all right.
Not soft. Yes.
Yeah. So, and I was like, hey, and he looked over at me, and I just chucked the ball right at his face and broke his nose.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
So what kind of discipline came after?
Yeah. So anyways, yeah, we're talking about the wolf. After That's right.
This. How did we deal with the wolf in this situation?
When Alec explained to me that there was a wolf in his heart and basically it was John's fault for not getting the wolf out, I said something like, we're going to deal with that wolf right now. So
we will exercise the wolf.
The wolf will, right. will be addressed in That's this right. moment.
Yes.
And we used to use paint stirrers. I used to use paint stirrers.
No, you didn't.
Yes, I did. But that wasn't
the only. You used to
only.
Use this.
Well, I used paint stirrers.
Oh, yeah. I brought a wooden spoon. Because whenever memes first came out, I still remember mom sending around a meme of a wooden spoon. And she's like, every Italian knows this is how you discipline your children.
Okay. I did wooden spoons, but I also did paint stirrers. Addison,
you did.
Yes. Thank yes. you.
That's right.
Thank you.
Paint stirrers was true. Yes. But, yes.
Alec, you didn't like it when I spanked you. Why was that?
Well, so basically Lisa's sitting in a certain position on this table right now because there's cameras going because she has one eye and we want to make sure we want to make sure that we play to her.
He talks stories in circles. Yeah,
the more I talk, the more it makes sense.
On, it will.
So my mom has only one eye. Mm. So her death perception sometimes is really off.
Oh.
And so even though my dad was way stronger and his spankings really hurt, they didn't hurt in places where they shouldn't have hurt.
Okay, no. Okay, this has nothing to do with my artificial eye.
No, this has nothing to do with
no,
that.
No, wait. Austin oh never my had gosh. A problem. Arden never had
oh,
a problem.
Oh, no. We could call Austin right now. I would like to phone a friend because it is true.
But
I'm going to get spanked later now.
So,
oh, my God. No. Okay, but here's the truth.
Wow.
I'm sorry. Yeah, we totally did reach back. I'm sorry.
Every parent has either spank their children when they shouldn't have.
Yeah.
Spank their children when they should have, but maybe not done it perfectly. Or has that question. Should children be spanked? Is that even a form of discipline? Or is that abuse? Is that punishment rather than discipline? Is that training anybody or is that only shaming them? And I think this is a conversation that is really important in this day, in this age. And even though, I'm really glad you guys can laugh about the ridiculousness of those moments and having four boys.
Oh, absolutely,
I'm just glad for the mercy of God.
No, you guys really did discipline well because every time there was a discipline at the very end, you would always hug us and it was always done out of love. And I think that you guys would wait to make sure you weren't angry at us before we disciplined.
I do feel like the wolf was addressed 3 hours after the incident.
I love what you shared, Mom. And something that you did is you took that time at the end to sit down with us, to pray with us, to work through it with us. But another thing that you and Dad always did so well is you made space for God to be God in our lives through your humility. Mm-hmm. And in those moments when you did discipline us wrong, we talk about this all the time on the show, humility creates safety,
right?
Safety to grow, safety to learn, safety to do the things that we need to do. And y'all did that so well. So maybe you didn't always discipline us perfectly. And I want people
not,
to hear
no,
that.
It's
okay.
Not a maybe.
You definitely discipline us perfectly.
Oh yeah.
And I think for parents, and we've navigated this, we have four kids, 7 to 14 years old, and you want to do right by your children.
Yeah.
And discipline is a massive part of our formation. And so when you don't do it right, it hurts as a parent. You feel it.
Oh, yeah.
And so I do think this is a place where there's a lot of shame and guilt and confusion that keeps people from disciplining with love and clarity and disciplining effectively. So that's part of the reason why I'm really excited that we're having this conversation, because there are wolves that need to be expelled from hearts. I mean, hey, I've had wolves in my heart to continue that language. Like, we all have that. We have that as adults. So how do we partner with God and the nature of God and the character of God and the heart of God to lead and guide our children through I'm going to call it the perils of discipline.
The perils of discipline.
Like, it's an area that has a lot of room for us doing it right and a lot of room for us doing it wrong.
Yeah. Well, and can I say something? And again, I love that you guys are doing it better. I mean, I watch you and Addison with your kids and you guys are doing it better. I grew up in a household that did not have discipline it had punishment and it was inconsistent. Like there was no clarity. Like I could be grounded for not eating oatmeal, but if I came in at 2 a.m. and made up some story that I drove all my drunk friends home so they could be safe, I wasn't grounded.
Yeah.
So there was no consistency. And my mother had grown up with abuse.
Yeah.
And because she'd grown up with abuse, she abused me. And so I grew up with anger and shame and hitting and kicking and slapping. And the comment was always, I'm sorry I did this, but you made me so angry. Yeah. So what I actually heard as a child was,
it's your fault.
Yeah. It was always my fault. And if I was better, then I wouldn't be mistreated or abused. And so I think as parents, we need to have that fresh start. I think if my mom had ever come to me and said, wow, I realize now that because I didn't get what I needed from my mom and I didn't have an example of discipline, I've been punitive with you. Will you forgive me? I think that she would have had all that shame erased and that perpetual cycle wouldn't have happened. And I think there's parents out there that have maybe mishandled discipline and been borderline shaming. Maybe it was even just verbal. We're not talking, it's not always spanking, shaming. And now they don't know how to recover their position of authority. So I want to kind of circle back to what Addison said. Parents need mercy. Parents need new beginnings. Parents need to be able to come to their kids and say, I disciplined you wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And God has disciplined me.
Yeah.
And I want to move forward with strength. So
that's good.
I even find in the midst of discipline incorrectly, when I have allowed myself to get angry or I've turned it into this struggle between us that it didn't need to be, because I think of like we're meant to be the calm in the midst of the storm.
Right.
Like as parents, you have the authority to not enter into the crazy. You're meant to rise above it. Whatever you need to do, if that's step out of the room for a couple minutes, call your spouse if they're not there, even hand it to your spouse. Yeah. If it really is a situation that you need your spouse to take over, specifically with like preteen, teenage boys.
Yeah.
I mean, I would love to even, a thought that came to my mind was you disciplining all of these boys while John was traveling. Like that's a whole other thing. But that's where I feel disciplined.
She was good at it. She was good at it, folks.
Sometimes she would just make the list for dad when dad got home.
That was Josh.
Only if he was going to get home in like an hour or two. And then it was, well, yeah, your dad's going to deal with this.
I was tired.
My God.
You can't leave it out there, but I'm sorry.
Yeah, go on.
I was saying
Dr.
is that.
Dr. Behringer.
That's true.
There was one time I did call outside help.
Yeah.
Do you remember that? Dr. Behringer showed up.
I actually wasn't a part of this one.
It was more Austin.
It was Austin.
It was Austin and Addison.
A little smarter.
I was terrified of Dr. Behringer.
You should have been.
He was a big military man that you called in just to back you up because you felt like you needed help. Yeah.
There was anarchy going on in the house.
John was gone. I remember that.
I'm beyond my depth. I'm going to call Dr. Behringer. He has five boys and he he's in Air Force guys.
Who drank tons and tons of milk.
Yes. They would go through 3 gallons of milk a day.
A day.
Anyway, we're off track. But
I was saying, I will be disciplined through those moments. And this is just me and different times where I've messed up. And I'm like, you know what? These kids are going to present another opportunity for me to walk through this discipline with them. This is for me. And it's not that I excuse their behavior, but that it becomes like, man, I really blew it. Or I have an interaction with those kids and my interaction with them bleeds into an interaction with Addison. And just that crazy cycle where you're like, okay, God, I see that you're disciplining me in this moment because we are not the ones who change our kids. That power is not in our hands.
Yeah, we train, but we can't change.
But we can't change.
Yeah.
Like we are only partnering with God who does the changing. And I think some parents will have such a pendulum swing of, gosh, these kids have gotten so bad because I haven't been consistent. Now I'm just going to come down really hard to try to figure it out. And it doesn't work like that, I have found.
Yeah, and I think the problem with spankings too, for a lot of people, at least the way spankings are understood, is spankings are going after the symptom, not the root cause.
Yeah.
Like I was talking to a buddy of mine, and he's a single dad, and he has a young daughter, and he actually listens to the show and was asking me some questions. And he said, so my 5-year-old daughter has gotten into this habit when she gets angry, or she will say things that are incredibly hateful. Things like, I want you to die.
Oh my gosh.
I hate you. I only love mom. I wish you weren't my dad. I mean, things that would be very difficult.
Arrows to your heart.
I mean, arrows to your heart.
Wow.
And the way he's navigated, and he has a beautiful heart toward his daughter. And the way he's navigating, he's like, you know, I've tried all these different things as far as consequences, and nothing's working. He's like, what happens is the consequences in the moment escalate the behavior. And it gets to a point where it's so irrational and so crazy that, like, I'm losing my sense of north.
And she's 5. Teenager.
Talking about a 5-year-old. He's losing his sense of north. The child is so far gone at that point, and she's clearly strong-willed. She's doubling down. And he was asking me some questions about, like, what I would do in his situation. And we have 2 daughters. We have 2 sons. And I actually shared a story with him about one of our daughters. And I asked Sophia if I could share this story, and she said I could. But when she was young, I mean, she probably, what, 3 years old?
Maybe, I don't know.
Maybe 4, 3 or 4. You had brought some correction to her that she did not like. And she was sitting on our kitchen counter, and she stood up with her little frame, stood up, and she goes, come over here. And you're like, wait, what? She's like, come over here so I can hit you in the face. And here she is, a 3-year-old.
I think she was taller.
Like, come over here. I'm going to hit you in the face.
Oh my God.
And it's just in these moments, and we've heard similar sentiments
and
at home.
So I did.
And so she
it
did.
It was my opportunity actually, to be disciplined by my
because you needed to be disciplined, so you walked over, you got hit the face. No. And we've been in those moments where we've heard, like, you're the worst parent ever. You're the worst mom. And things like that, particularly from daughters, at least in our family, less sons, more so daughters. And it's like, okay, what's actually going on in this moment? Like, what's behind this? Because what inevitably happens, and this happens with his daughter too, is an hour later, 2 hours later, 30 minutes later, she's bawling. She's like, I'm so sorry, Dad. I don't mean any of those things. I think you're amazing. I love you. I don't want to say this. It's like, okay, how do we get from this moment of insanity to a moment of clarity faster? Like, for me as a parent, I want to spend less time with my kids.
That is definitely the question.
In the space of insanity.
Yeah, no, no.
You know what I'm saying?
No. And then
we'll let them.
We'll go back to that story. We'll go back to that story. But
no, Addison,
but
you're
that's
right.
The question as parents.
What you just asked, how do you get from that moment of, like, if things finally calm down, people actually think rationally, people actually love each other, and they return to that love. They know that, like, oh, my mom actually does love me, or oh, my dad does love me,
how do we move through this? And if you look at, so scientifically, we don't process the world the way we normally do when we're angered or aroused. I mean, it's just, we are predictably irrational.
Yeah.
When we're angered or aroused. So when you're dealing with a child whose prefrontal cortex, which is that executive function, the ability to separate between stimulus and response.
Yeah.
When you're dealing with a child whose prefrontal cortex is not fully developed, those don't get fully developed even into our 20s. How do you navigate those moments where you're like, I know you don't really know what you're doing right now, but I also need to hold you responsible for what you're doing right now, because what you're doing right now, it has consequences. It will affect people. You can't say these things without affecting people. And so I was talking to my friend, and I said, okay, in this moment, how do we get from insanity to clarity? Okay. And I said, what you have to remember as her father is, number one, like, you're the adult. She's the child. You don't get to be the child. And I think for many of us in those moments, we have a tendency to revert to things that maybe we wanted to express when we were children, or this desire to express that, like, we feel a certain way, or we feel hurt, we feel pain. As a parent, y'all, that's not the moment to do it. Like, your children can't process that. And so it's our responsibility as parents in that moment to take a step back and remember, we are the parent. Number two, remembering that what she is saying, like she's not in a position to be engaged with rationally until she 100%. Calms down. So you've got to get her to calm down before you try to explain or rationalize. She will not be able to track with your logic if you go into that mode when she's in that frame of mind. So that was number two. I said, number three, this is how I would phrase it to her. I just heard you say this and this really hurt. I don't think that's what you were trying to communicate though. Are you trying to communicate a different message, or would you like to communicate that differently? I want to give you another chance to communicate what you just communicated. I know you're hurt. I know you're upset, but I know communicating like this is only going to make you more hurt and more upset. Mm-hmm. You take it down in that moment as a parent. Sometimes, and I've done this with my kids, sometimes they see it right away and they're like, I'm so sorry. I see what you're saying. I do want to say that differently. I didn't mean that. Would you please forgive me? And then we can move into clarity very quickly. We can talk about consequences. We can talk about what needs to happen that's appropriate so they don't make that mistake or communicate like that. All of that can happen. But in my worst, I go straight to consequences in those moments. Mm-hmm. And it's like consequence on top of consequence on top of consequence.
Where'd you learn that
and
from?
Consequence. And then you get to a point as a parent, where like, you have no other consequences to deal out. And you're saying things that you have no intention of following through on. You will never talk to another friend again. You know, and it's like, this isn't working. And I remember one time specifically with Asher. I had one of these moments where like I lost my sanity with him and I broke down and started crying. And I was like, son, I am so sorry. Like and he broke down and started crying. And this was a few years ago. And it was a moment of breakthrough for him. There was a certain pattern of behavioral issues.
Do you think he saw your humanity?
He saw my humanity. Yeah. And he also saw that
the effects
yeah, that it was having on me. Like I wasn't making it about me, because some parents will do that weird manipulation thing. Yes. Mm-hmm. It's okay to let your kids show that you are a person and that you have feelings and you're not a robot, because sometimes kids will believe that their parents are robotic. And that's dangerous. Like, it's good for your kids to see your emotions, but it's not good for your kids to be manipulated by your emotions.
Yeah.
And there's a big difference.
It's very well said.
Between those two.
Yeah.
And so when it comes to that process of discipline, to show your children like, hey, this isn't a robotic moment where I'm grabbing a spoon or I'm dealing out consequences. Like, I love you and I'm expressing my love for you in this moment in a way that's going to lead to your growth and transformation. And that is a massive part of your development process. And it says in Hebrews 12, it says that God corrects those he claims. Like, only illegitimate children aren't disciplined. And how many adults, y'all, struggle to receive discipline from God or from bosses at work or whatever it is, because they never actually received discipline at home in a way that communicated love and this fact that I see potential in you and I'm willing to walk this road with you because I value you. We could talk about like practical disciplining techniques and all that. And I think that's important. But I think what's behind that and what's behind discipline for us as parents to understand is way more important, because we heard this one time. I can't remember who shared this, but he talked about spankings like a hammer. Mm-hmm. And he said like a hammer is a tool that you can use to build a house. Mm-hmm. But if you try to build a house with just a hammer, you're going to get yourself into trouble.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of parents, especially in like the conservative Christian world, grew up believing that when it comes to disciplining your kids, you just grab that hammer and you beat that hammer as many times as you have to beat that hammer. Hmm. And
yeah, I think that was very much pushed. I know that there was a whole teaching practice of discipline when you guys were little, and somebody gave me the course and I thought, I'm going to be spanked. Like, I can't even live up to this standard. This is so intense where kids were going to constantly be spanked. And it was the rod of correction. It was super intense.
Yeah.
Mm. And I do think when that happens, people pull completely away instead of what you're saying is using it only when it's necessary.
And I think parents know this, and just giving parents permission, like, to pause in those moments.
Not even permission. Like it is a necessity.
You have to, because if you discipline, and we talk about this with our kids too, it's like, that's, and I mentioned this earlier, that's not the moment to throw out consequences when they're making the mistake. Because if you threaten them, then they're going to default to only hearing from you when you threaten them, rather than explaining to them and teaching them. And there's a difference between threats and threatening people and teaching them. Like, hey, when you make these decisions, there are consequences that come with those decisions. Unfortunately, there are a lot of people who don't understand the cause and effect relationship that our choices have on the world and our relationships. We're supposed to learn that in childhood in a safe environment, that is guided and created by people who love us and truly want the best for our lives. Unfortunately, that doesn't always happen. And so for us as parents, knowing, like, you can pause and take a step back, because it's never appropriate for your exercising of discipline to be a cathartic expression or release of your anger or frustration or dissatisfaction with your child or reaction. It's completely inappropriate. Mm-hmm. And I think everyone needs to hear that. Like, it's completely inappropriate for you to discipline a child like that.
Well, and the child doesn't even remember.
No. They don't. Well,
they only remember you're crazy. They don't remember the lesson you're trying to teach them. I remember only the crazy moments when my mom came after me. I do not remember what I ever even did wrong. And, you know, and I do think that, you know, what you're saying is parents have the right to change the environment.
Yes.
Ask the child to go to the room, walk out, take a drink of water, because when there's chaos in the environment, nobody's going to have a healthy response. Nobody's going to move forward with strength. And there is a generation that thinks forgiveness means no consequence. Mm. And the truth is, you can forgive your child for acting up, saying, I hate you, Dad. I wish you would. That, of course, he forgives his daughter, but there's consequence to those word choices.
Absolutely.
And not punishment, consequence.
I would actually say that forgiveness is what creates the conditions for you to have clarity
to make the consequences
appropriate and to connect the dots that you otherwise can't connect. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the reasons why we have this either or idea of forgiveness and justice, forgiveness and consequences, is because we haven't done the difficult kingdom work, and it is difficult of bringing those two together. Mm-hmm. And that's going back to what we were saying earlier. It is so important that we create the environment where kids, as they're being developed, they can start to bring those things together when we make mistakes as parents. Because I've made the mistake of disciplining my children in anger, or of throwing out, threatening something in order to get them to do what I needed them to do in that moment. And I circle back to them, because the Holy Spirit will tell you, if you parents, I mean, I would just encourage y'all right now to pray this, like, just pray, Holy Spirit, show me in those moments. I give you permission. Like, you care for these children. You search and you know their hearts. You search and you know my heart. Please show me in those moments. And when you go to them, I'm telling y'all, and this is how God works in his redemptive style. When you go to them after you made those mistakes and you own it and you model that humility for them, the bond of trust that is created between you and them, and even more importantly, between them and God, they start to understand how God engages with them and how God responds to their failures and how God sees them.
That's good. Awesome.
It's revolutionary. And we were part of a couples group last night, and one of the people in our group asked for prayer, because as an adult, this individual struggles to discern between the voice of accusation and the father's voice of correction.
And discipline.
Mm. To this day. And like, I want to be disciplined. I want to be challenged by God. Mm. I know this is an outworking of God's love for me, but there is this history of accusation. There is this tone of accusation. There's this culture of accusation that she's struggling to remove herself from so she can receive from God.
Or to find God in the midst of, which is probably the wrong question.
And the prayer was like, I don't want to pass this down to my children. Mm-hmm. That was the prayer. That's what we were praying for as a group last night. And so, like, y'all, this is serious stuff. Discipline is very important to God, because it's a part of how, again, going back to Hebrews 12, we share in his holiness. We understand his nature. His holiness is his nature. Like, what makes him God and what he's calling us into as his sons and daughters. And so we can't afford to allow people who have no heart for God to define how we discipline.
Yeah.
And we can't afford to allow whatever's going on in our world to dictate how we discipline. We have to submit to the power of the Holy Spirit. And I believe Holy Spirit wants to meet us in these moments because of how important these moments are in the lives of our children.
Hmm. Well, it's almost like a second chance to heal from things that we didn't heal from in our childhood. You know, when we actually allow him to speak into, why did I react that way? Instead of saying, well, I reacted that way because all of this was done to me and this
you made me react that way.
Which is what I always heard. You made me mad. You made me angry. You made me hit you. So we get a chance to own it and then heal, because God circles around and says to your friend, you hear accusation when all I am saying to you is, I believe better things of you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is not who you are or how I've called you to behave. I don't know. Whenever I've owned a mistake, God has never said to me shaming words. He has never said, I've been wondering if you were going to ever confess that. This has been bothering me for a long time.
Yeah.
He always speaks better things, you know.
Embraces.
Yes. Yeah. He always welcomes. Yes, there's discipline. There might be an action. Like you need to go to your husband. You need to go to that friend. But it's always a belief of better things. And I think as parents, that's what we have to position our children with. Mm-hmm. I'm disciplining you, kind of like pruning, so that you can bear more fruit, because I see what is on your life that you're missing. Mm-hmm. And in this moment, it's undermining your future.
And I think that is such a beautiful gift, that as parents, you are given eyes to see your children like no one else is going to. So you do get to see those opportunities. And that is key, that you view every single moment or shortcoming or failure in your kids as opportunity. And in order to see it as opportunity, you have to separate yourself from your kids' choices. You have to be able to be confident enough in yourself and in your position as a parent to say, okay, they made this mistake. I am saddened by this mistake that they've made, but I'm not going to allow my own shame that my kid could do such a thing to start to confuse and pervert the beautiful opportunity that is now presented for us to move through this thing that's exposed. Look at the exposure as a gift. Don't look at it as this, you know, dark cloud. Aren't all the family starting a ministry down the road? Like, yeah, we're human.
Yeah.
But I think for parents to recognize, okay, that's okay. Like, I don't need to protect our reputation. Like, I mean, very recently we joined the neighborhood school and a situation arose and my knee jerk was like, oh, this is one of the first interactions. This is one of the first things that they're going to think of our family. And the Lord was so sweet to immediately be like, what a gift.
One of our kids did something that they should not have done at school.
Straight up lie.
Straight up lie.
Character.
Oh, yeah. No.
Yeah.
Like, and character flaw. Yeah. Like, I wanted to be like, listen, I just want you to know we're great people. Like,
when Alex's teachers would call me, I'd be like, my first two kids are in AP classes.
So good.
They're in AP classes. I promise I practiced.
Like, well, wait, they were in AP classes when I was in fifth grade?
You mean they were AB students?
I was thinking, like, I was thinking in high school.
But
I was like, what's happened? I promise.
But then immediately to him, like, this is a teacher in their 60s. Yeah. They have had so many, whatever grade and said child is in.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't need to explain to them. I just need to say, hey, what can we do?
Yeah.
How can we go after this together?
Yeah.
And so I just think that is what grace looks like in a situation like this, where it's like, you know what? you are a person and I am a person and this is an opportunity. Let's move through it in the safety of you as a child and me as a parent. What a blessing that it's not your 25-year-old coming to you like, Mom, I just threw a baseball at someone's face. It was just a flick.
You were probably like 8.
Yes. I was probably like 8.
Very clear.
You were
I was young.
What I'm hearing, and I was just writing this down, is that discipline.
You're taking notes.
I am.
Yes.
Discipline is ultimately about freedom, not bondage. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just different things. Discipline is ultimately about healing and wholeness, not punishment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
And I think as we realize, we're actually creating conditions for freedom through discipline. And a part of the discipline is to create appropriate consequences and to create the appropriate environment so the person can learn, so that they can move into freedom and more responsibility beyond that environment.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, what Julie's talking about as well is very close to that of like that, like what a gift, Julie, you were talking about, like with God was like, hey, what a gift, like this opportunity. I remember whenever I worked at Apple.
So you're an adult now.
Now I'm an adult. This point in the story. I wasn't being spanked.
You were the youngest employee at this Apple store, right?
Well, I was the youngest employee. Well, the youngest manager.
Youngest manager.
Yeah, I was 19.
Okay. Take that, teacher. Yeah.
Well, no.
Hire it.
Take that.
All because of spankings.
Where's this?
No. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. So there would be some times, like going back to a lot of these things that you guys were talking about right now, about the correction is an opportunity for growth for everyone.
Yeah.
And in the Apple store, I was a manager. And I would have people come in who literally, I would know that either A, they were lying, or B, they were just, like as I was saying, they were uncomprehendable at like the time, like they wouldn't think logically. And both those people, I would always get excited, and everyone at the store would always give them to me. So like literally they'd be like,
these are customers
who come in, right? So these are adults. And that moment was always a moment. Of course I wasn't spanking them,
but hang on.
But what I'm getting at is this, is it was a moment to kind of, to take what seemingly a horrible situation, kind of like what you're talking about with like your kids, and turn that into actually a really great opportunity for, it wasn't just like learning for them, but really it was actually to have them align and have them understand and have like this knowing. And it would actually make them, whenever they left the Apple store, a promoter of Apple. And every time they'd want to come in, they'd always want to work with me. And they actually felt heard, because I think a lot of times whenever we were getting spanked, sometimes we really wanted to be heard as well, because we felt like maybe we weren't being like we felt like we had our side of the story, and you guys did really good at hearing us
sometimes.
But what
I
Addison, you know what, I'll just talk about what Addison, what you're talking about is making sure that there's that moment of actually listening.
Yeah.
And then once there's that understanding, even though there's still, you know, maybe some consequences, like there's that big understanding, and that would make the biggest promotion. Like that makes the biggest promoter for me. Like what you're talking about, that's the opportunity, because emotions are so high. Those are the moments that you remember the most. Just handling that well, I know, is huge.
You're moving them from insanity to clarity. Because you knew that if you try to engage with them in that frame of mind, or they were acting like an insane person, you could present the best argument in the world, and they're not going to hear you.
Yeah.
But if you move them to that point of clarity through them feeling understood, through them getting a chance to express themselves, all of those things.
Yeah, it doesn't have that much to do with discipline.
No, but it's
not that I really think about it. But what I'm getting at is
resolution.
And that's what I got from it.
That's what you're saying.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. And that's why I'm bringing it back to the insanity.
Exactly.
Clarity,
it
idea.
Is about that conflict resolution, that is a moment that actually is going to be staple, and it will actually set you up better for the future.
Yeah.
Agreed.
Yeah.
And I think that's where we need to leave people as we close this episode. And Alec, I would love it if you prayed.
You want me to pray?
Pray this out today. Yeah. As we close this episode, it's just remembering in those moments, insanity to clarity. Okay.
Yeah.
Number two, this is not a space for us to release whatever frustration, pain, whatever it is that we're navigating. Yeah. Take a step back.
Whatever amount of time.
We have got to be the calm in the storm. We can't expect our kids to calm down if we're not first willing to calm down and embrace the calm. Number three, we mentioned this in a much earlier episode, like the gift of the do-over. Give them a chance. Say, hey, I know you. I know you and I know your heart. Like, speak life over them. Speak blessing over them, not from a place of manipulation, but from a place of, I genuinely see this in you, and allow them to restate it and remember.
Calling them up, not out, you're saying.
Well, you got to call them up even before you call them out, because sometimes you do have to call people out. But first call them up before you call them out. And the other thing that I share that I think is real important, and we share this in different ways, is like, it's okay for your kids to see your emotions. Like, it's okay for your kids to see your humanity, whether that's through you apologizing or you navigating, like, expressing how you feel in that moment, but you can't manipulate with your emotions.
You know, that's good. Before you pray, I just want to leave them with the scripture. Proverbs 22:6 says, train up a child in the way he should go. That's what we're talking about, the calling them up. And in keeping with his individual gift or bent. And when he is old, he will not depart from it. And in Jesus' name, this works for girls too. Amen.
Boys and girls.
He is old.
Amen.
And guys, I know we didn't have a burning question at the beginning, but this has actually been a big burning question, and really just want to shout out Juliana 9739.
Is that you?
Really asked. No, it wasn't. It wasn't Juliana Bevere.
I'm doing what I can, team.
But no, she was wondering if we could please speak to how to navigate rebellious children. We really hope, Juliana, this really helped you, and thank you guys even always for sending your questions. It really, really helps. But let's go right ahead and let's pray over everyone. So Father God, right now, thank you so much for this conversation that's happened today. And God, I just want to speak right now to every new parent, to anyone who maybe was just like Lisa, they maybe did not have a good relationship with their parents, and they felt like they were disciplined horrible, and that they don't know that if they're going to do things right, and they think that they're going to do things wrong. Father God, I just speak life just into these situations. And God, I just thank you so much for those new parents, but parents who are already parenting children and already correcting children, that God, you gave them these children, and that these parents are qualified, that these parents are the parents that were given these children for a reason. And so, Father God, we thank you so much that you can build up every single parent, God, that you have blessed every single one, that they are ordained by you. So, Father God, we just pray just supernatural wisdom whenever it comes down to correction. Like Addison said earlier, we know that this is a very important time. So Father God, we just pray that every parent would just have sound mind. That God, we just pray for the hearts of these children. That God, we thank you so much that like your word says, that whenever you discipline us, that you claim us your own. So Father God, we pray that this word would go out and that it would change lives in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Hey guys, thank you so much for joining us again at Home with the Beveres, where we are so passionate about helping you create a legacy starting at home. If you haven't already, go right ahead and like and subscribe. And guys, as well, leave us a comment below, because whenever you leave a comment, it helps us curate content that can help so many other people. Again, guys, thank you so much for joining, and we'll see you next time at Home with the Beveres.